Hello everyone, this is Bob and Threadbare, and welcome back to the Crew 2.
Oh, I'm also here. I'm Great Joe. Hello.
Right now I am flying a plane.
So you are. This is new.
Would you happen to know what kind of plane I'm flying? Oh, by the way, that's smoke. You can just make smoke appear. It does nothing, but there it is.
You know, I'm all for it. I'm all for smoke happening. I'm not sure, though, guessing just by what you picked before, I'm gonna guess P-51 Mustang.
Actually, not this time.
Oh, dang.
My P-51 is, silver. This plane is red.
That means it goes faster. So, well, I'm out of ideas.
Well, you're gonna see it soon. After I recover from that crash. From turning into a motorcycle in midair. Okay, so which way am I heading? The wrong way. Okay, so today we are heading to the Freestyle headquarters.
Ooh.
That is why we're in the plane, because the Freestyle begins with its plane discipline.
Oh. That's pretty cool.
And here we are.
An abandoned milling plane? Oh!
I believe this is a reference to Burning Man.
I was gonna say that might be set on fire someday.
Yeah. Seems like something they'd want to do. So this here is Emmett. He's your fixer for Freestyle.
Hey.
And the ace is actually his daughter, Sophia.
Ooh.
Now, once again, we've got an interesting twist, because in this case, neither one of them is an asshole.
Oh. Are they just good sportsmen?
Sophia is insane, but she's not an asshole.
Hmm.
That, by the way, is your prize for winning the Freestyle and beating Sophia. That hovercraft. And that was her just then, in the jumpsuit.
Hmm.
Now, like the other headquarters, this place has all the same booths driven in or set up quickly, based on the materials here. Oh, that's interesting. Spirit of England.
Okay. Of course there's a TVR.
Yep. Two street races and one rallycross vehicle.
Hmm.
And by the way, I did check, and the price is based on the cars you don't have.
Oh.
So you won't overspend if you own one of the cars in a bundle.
Well, that's nice. I do wonder about how it would go outfitting a TVR of any make for rallying.
Well, that was a street race car, so I guess we'll never know. Okay, so that first one there has a unique image, but that is not actually not does not have any cutscenes with it.
Hmm.
So we're just going to skip that one. Alright, now I'm in my P-51, but again, this is my auto-racing vehicle. My aerobatics vehicle is a Spitfire. Right foot tool for the right job. And this is the Dakota Grasslands level. And that is Mount Rushmore.
What are you saving your best maneuvers for? Come on!
Wow. Oh, there it is.
So, interesting note about this checklist. While the checklist is active, you won't get any points for doing anything that's not on the list. But you can do anything on the list in any order, and anything you do that is on the list is worth double points, plus you get a bonus for completing the checklist. However, if you don't like the checklist, you can turn it off. I'll point that out once we get to our next one. Whoops. Yeah, checklist sequence. Underneath there, you see hold to skip the checklist. Other note, if you kill yourself, that does not stop your session. Which is good to know.
That's handy. Wow.
I may want some extra space to do this outside loop here. By the way, that's the nuclear power plant in the distance.
Yes.
Whoops.
Whoops indeed.
So, something else to note. Look in the lower left-hand corner. You see the white and the black bars?
Yeah?
Those are your instruments. They tell you, which way is up, and what your inclination is.
Huh.
And just beneath the miles per hour... Whoops. Just beneath the miles per hour, you've got your current altitude. And I believe that is based on how far above the ground you are, not above sea level.
So, are there any of these that you have to do in just zero visibility?
Funny you should mention that. Keep watching.
I knew this was gonna fuck me up. Oh. I feel like the scenery.
Yeah.
Nice vest and... Well, there's the presence.
And you can see that the scoring for this style is actually pretty tight, because that's the world record in the upper right-hand corner, 22,000. Oh look, there's a giant cow. Let's go look at the giant cow.
Of course there's a... Wait, there was a giant cow in the first crew.
Yeah, that's because there is a giant cow in America.
Only in America, of course.
Yeah.
I kind of want to visit that giant cow.
This is actually just west of Lake Superior right here, which is about as much of Minnesota as there is in this game. The fact that there is a west end of Lake Superior.
Oh.
Crap. Well, you get the idea. So, you may have noticed that I am playing these on normal. This is a scoring-type game, so the only difference between the difficulty levels is how many points you need to get to win. So there's really nothing to see by taking a higher difficulty level.
That's fair.
Plus, I don't think I've gotten enough points yet.
Hurry up and beat my record so I can take it back.
That's Sophia. That's her attitude about a lot of things right there.
Yeah, she seems very much into just the spirit of competition, I guess.
Yeah. But, welcome to the National Mall.
There it is.
Washington, D.C. is kind of tiny on this map, but here it is.
Yeah.
Just past the Capitol building, and that's the Washington Monument there. And behind it is the Lincoln Memorial. So this time the soundtrack is not John Philip Sousa, but I figured a march would be appropriate for Washington.
Yeah, definitely.
Interesting note about the loops, by the way, is that they're very particular. You need to be level And you need to go completely vertical movement. No horizontal movement at all. And that's important to know. Because if you press the emergency brake button while you're in a plane, you enter extreme mode, which makes the handling much more quick and snappy.
Ah, yes. I believe that's from another Ubisoft property.
Whoops.
You might recall Tom Clancy's Hawks.
I remember hearing about it. Never played it.
They had a whole thing where you could turn off every assist with a button. That was like, you had to train to do it. And it also ruined the camera.
Close call, by the way, is kind of a tricky thing to get. You notice I kept driving close to those buildings and didn't get a close call. I think what you have to do to get it is aim for a building and then, you know, move out of the way at the last possible second without hitting it. Few repeated buildings here. This isn't one of the primary cities, so there's a lot of cut and paste. At least outside of, you know, the mall itself here. And I think some of the side buildings are Smithsonian museums.
Oh, just a number of them?
Yeah. Well, Smithsonian museums basically line the National Mall on both sides. Everything that isn't a monument is a museum.
Well, sure. Why not?
We're not quite done here, though. Because I want to get a closer look at the Lincoln Memorial. Just ruined that guy's bicycle. Whoops.
Sure am glad he was not it.
Yeah. Well, like I said before, even if you hit a person, you didn't actually hit a person in this game. Alright, let's get drive right up here on the unpaved grass that is actually very paved in real life, and wait a second. Did you see that? Pretty sure that's not Mr. Lincoln.
Is that something you got a license? Do you got a license?
No, it's an
Honest Abe.
It's a national monument. It is government property. They don't trademark anything.
I can't believe they removed Old Hickory.
Alright. But now we are in the Great Basin. So, do you know about the Continental Divide?
You mean like,
Well, it's this thing in North America where all the water, all the rivers, flows either into the Atlantic or the Pacific.
Ah, right. Can't sail through it.
And there is a line towards the west side of the continent that, divides the continent between, you know, Atlantic and Pacific. But then there's the Great Basin. The Great Basin doesn't go anywhere. It is so dry there is no water to go west or east.
Huh. Wait. Is that how you got the Dust Bowl?
Oh no. Dust Bowl was erosion.
Okay.
And yes, this, by the way, is the low visibility map. Fortunately, there's this bare patch of ground here where you can practice some, or where you can get some low altitude flying in. That's always good for some solid points during the freestyle mode.
Nice.
And you can also see there's something called touch and go, where you just, you know, tap the ground with your wheels.
like a little skip. A happy little plane that you got going there.
Alright. And when you're rolling, you'll want to use extreme mode because you spin faster. Mm-hmm. But when you do a loop, you don't want to use roll because it snaps you off to one side so you can't do completely vertical movement. For some reason, a rudder turn is called air drifting.
Oops. Sure.
So, yeah, I'm going vertical here, but I can only tell because of the instruments. Yeah, this is incredible right here.
It's just an endless void.
Yep. You would be battered to pieces if this was real, though.
I'd be...
You outdid Sophia. Where'd you find the gumption to do that?
Yeah, I'd be...
I'm just saying that clouds are very turbulent inside.
Oh, yeah, that they are. It's everybody's least favorite part of landing.
And this is above the clouds. This is above the clouds. It is an incredible view up here. But of course, they have to change the weather for this race, for this event. So, once we finish all of this stuff, we will see what time and weather conditions are. Normally.
Oh.
And they are very pretty. There's the Salt Flats. I believe that's Las Vegas behind there.
Oh.
And this is just about sunset, I believe.
Oh, that's... Oh.
What? Well, anyway, like always, some time has passed, and so some more street races have appeared. This one is through the Everglades.
Ooh.
So, I'm gonna need an appropriate vehicle for that. How about this weird thing?
Ah. Yeah, this is a market that was just happening right around when Top Gear was, dying.
Three.
Ever so slowly.
One.
And appearing on Amazon.
Yeah, the track exclusive car for track days. It's an odd market, but
yeah.
Well, people bought into it, right?
I don't know. I'm not keeping track of any sales records. But yeah, this is the Everglades. And this is a pretty nice car for it, I'd say.
Oh, yeah.
Down at the southern tip of Florida. As a matter of fact, I think I might want to change my perspective here in a little bit.
Oh, boy.
Because obviously I've just left the competition behind, so this is just a nice cruise through this part of the map.
Fair point.
Got some tropical music going on in the background. Smashing up some signs.
Oh yeah, I love it.
Yeah, nice views though.
Yeah, I like those trees. I wonder, is there like a rising tide over here? I wonder what those...
Oh no, no, they don't change the water levels anywhere. That would be amazing if they could though.
Oh, yeah. I'm just wondering about those tree roots.
The Everglades are fresh water, so they don't change from the tide or anything. And gotta love how authentic this is. The shitty liquid crystal display there in the center.
Yeah. I think I've only seen one car with a console as very good as that. It's called the Chevrolet Spark, and it was designed to be an electric vehicle until it got refitted with an internal combustion engine.
Did it?
Absolutely tiny.
So is it what, a plug-in hybrid now?
I'm not sure. I don't think they could. I don't think they could fit it with a hybrid. There's like a Spark EV that's just completely electric. It's the kind of thing where you could, a single person can get it out of a ditch.
You know, his hand keeps reaching for that gear shifter, but the gear shifter never moves, unfortunately. Not on any of the vehicles, from what I can see. But interesting note is that that center device is measuring your speed in terms of kilometers per hour.
Oh yeah, KTM is a Austrian, somewhere along those lines.
But you can tell because it says we're going 300, and by MPH in the corner there it says 200. Mm-hmm. All right, here's the finish line. Competition is nowhere in sight.
Oh man.
So as weird as this vehicle is, it is a competent racer. Of course, it probably helped that this was a very straight line race.
Oh yeah.
Let's see what else we can get up to on this video. Alright, what else is new? A whole bunch of races dropped since the last time we did videos.
Ooh.
Oh! To the big cow, then.
Oh. Oh, to the big cow.
Yeah, apparently this one just drives past that big cow we saw earlier.
Why not?
So this is going to be through the northern part of the map. I figure... yeah. Let's get a racing motorcycle in this. Sure. You know, rather than that Indian. I mean, no offense to Indians and Harley Davidsons, but they are not built for racing.
What is this thing? I'm gonna have to look that makeup. I've never heard of MV Agassa.
3, 2, 1.
The motorcycle may have been a mistake. Looks like it's kinda cold outside.
Oh, well, got your jacket.
At least there's that. But yeah, I'm kind of getting covered by ice here.
Oh. It's a good touch, at least.
Yeah.
Wouldn't want to be there, but it's a good touch.
Well, I guess we're going through the Northern Rockies here. So this part of the map is basically Yellowstone Park. It's... man, I'm covered now.
Oh. Can't be good.
But, oh, by the way, so, I imagine that you are familiar with driving on ice and snow.
A bit, yeah.
And I'm from Minnesota, so, the same. So I figured we might talk a bit about that.
Yeah.
How I've got this one rule about driving on ice and snow. You can turn, or you can change your speed, but never both at the same time.
It's a good rule. It's something that we got in driving school. Like, driving instructors would say the exact same thing.
They didn't really explain that in driving school here. that you were saying?
Yeah, I also got that exact same advice from my mom and dad when I was taking the lessons, so...
Yeah. But, I will say, though, that despite those racing tires on this thing, it's actually holding its grip pretty well on the icy roads.
Yeah.
I mean, you do lose some traction. It's not as bad as it is in real life. Speaking of real life, you know, every sort of thing that you think of when you think of Minnesota, the ice and snow-covered landscape, that's what it looks like this winter. As of this recording, we are expecting another 2 to 4 inches of snow, and it's March.
Oh boy.
Hey, there's a big cow.
I don't think I'll be seeing any snow for until next winter.
Yeah, that's that being close to water thing going for you.
Heck yeah.
Regulates the climate.
Yeah, and a small landmass helps too.
Yeah, as opposed to Minnesota, which is kind of near the geographical center of the continent. Rain has to travel a long ways to get to us. And actually, that's why we get more snow and ice in the months next to winter, rather than in winter. Because in winter, all of the wind is coming down out of the north, and that wind is completely dry.
Makes sense.
Oh, hey, that's a nice touch. You can see the snow shadows cast by the highway there.
Ooh. It's pretty nice.
Alright, and now that we're resetting back to the regular climate, just want to show you something here quick. Instantly brown.
Oh.
Yep, same decals for mud and for snow.
I like that there's different patches. It's nice.
So, just one last thing I wanted to show you. I was just doing some digging around, and I decided to record this.
Sure.
This is me at the game's ceiling, 15,000 feet.
Oh.
And this is what you can see from there. Right now I am flying above Los Angeles, and that is Las Vegas in the distance.
Oh, wow.
And when you get close to the ceiling, there's this weird ripple effect in the sky.
Hmm.
And you slow down to zero. And start falling once you hit the ceiling.
Oh no! this might be my worst nightmare right now.
Really? Just falling out of the sky on a motorcycle?
It is now!
Oh, don't
oh,
worry.
Crap.
We'll be fine.
Oh, sweet lordy.
There, see? Oh. We're fine.
We're fine.
Nothing
this
bad
fine.
Happened. I just fell up 15,000 feet out of the sky. And off we go. On to another adventure.
There we go.
Okay, so today I was planning on covering 1971's Vanishing Point, but it turns out I need a physical copy, and I forgot to order one in advance. So I will be getting to it eventually, but until it arrives, I will be moving on down the list. That means today we'll be taking a look at a 1994 thriller called Speed. The story about the story. Speed is an original story, created by screenwriter Graham Yost. He apparently based it on an older movie called Runaway Train, because he believed the movie would have been better if there had been a bomb on board, and if the train had been a bus. Apparently his first thought was to have the bus drive around a stadium at 20 miles an hour, and to have the whole film take place on the bus. Presumably these decisions were to make the movie cheaper to film, but the studio that picked it up, 20th Century Fox, had money to burn, As such, the minimum speed went up to 50 miles an hour, the beginning and ending of the movie take place entirely off the bus, and the bus spends most of its time on the highway, performing action stunts. Fox would produce the movie, but Paramount was the first studio to show interest. That's worth mentioning because Paramount also wanted to put Die Hard director John McTiernan behind the camera. McTiernan would pass on the job because he thought the script was a little too much like Die Hard, but he did suggest giving Jan de Bont the director's seat instead. De Bont had been McTiernan's cinematographer for Die Hard and The Hunt for Red October, so he was a good fit for the role. One other famous name who contributed was Joss Whedon, who would write the vast majority of the final draft dialogue. The lead character in Speed, Jack Traven, would be played by Keanu Reeves, but he wasn't exactly the first choice for the role. At this point in his career, Reeves was best known for playing Ted in Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure, and while he'd starred in an action movie before, 1991's Point Break, it didn't have the best reception at the time, and he starred alongside the much more experienced Patrick Swayze. Still, nobody else wanted the job, in part because the original version of Jack Traven was a wisecracking clone of John McClane. Keanu Reeves and Joss Whedon would end up making the character much more serious. The female lead, Annie Porter, would be played by Sandra Bullock. Bullock is a famous actor today, but Speed was her first big movie, and just like Reeves, she was not the first choice for the role. On the other hand, Dennis Hopper was the first choice for his role, but oddly enough, his character wasn't going to be the final villain until after he'd accepted it. Hopper, if you aren't aware, is both an actor and a director whose first directing job was 1969's Easy Rider, and who played a major role in Apocalypse Now. Speed doesn't exactly feature an iconic car, but it does feature a bus, and that bus is a GM New Look, nicknamed the Fishbowl for having a curved front window. GM built the first New Look in 1959. And it built the last one in 1977, almost 20 years before Speed began production. Presumably, the production team went with an older model because they needed a lot of them, 11 to be precise. Plus, public transportation fleets tend to use a range of new and old models, so it's not like an old bus would look out of place. Speed was the number one movie of its opening weekend, and all told, it would make $350.4 million on a $30 million budget. It got a very positive reception from critics, too, since while it never aspires to be more than a mindless action movie, it's very good at being an action movie. As such, I don't think it'll take too long to describe the story. We begin the movie with the villain, who stabs a security guard who happens to spot him screwing around in a skyscraper's elevator shaft. He then blows two bombs on a full elevator car, but the elevator's emergency brakes keep it from plummeting. The elevator stays stuck, and so we move on to meet our protagonist, Jack Traven, and his partner, Harry Temple, two Los Angeles SWAT officers who are part of the emergency response. They get their briefing from Lieutenant McMahon, Mac for short, who explains that the bomber is holding 13 passengers hostage and wants $3 million in 1 hour or he'll blow the emergency brakes. Response took 40 minutes, so SWAT has their work cut out for them. The elevator is an express, so Jack and Harry have to go in through an access panel to enter the elevator shaft and look for the bomb. As they examine it, Harry gives Jack a pop quiz about an airport hostage situation, and Jack suggests shooting the hostage so the perp can't drag her all the way to a plane. Meanwhile, the bomber is in another elevator listening in, ready to blow the charges early if they try to rescue his hostages. Jack gets a bright idea to attach the elevator to a roof crane, but the bomber suspects something's up and detonates the brakes. The crane catches the elevator, but it buckles from the load. Fortunately, it buys them enough time to save the passengers, and since the bomber blew his charge early, Jack and Harry work out that he must be hiding in the building on an unchecked freight elevator. The two go straight in, with no backup, and the bomber gets the jump on them with a shotgun. When he runs out of ammo, he keeps them at bay with the dynamite strapped to his chest, and a dead man switch that will go off if he drops it, and he uses his hot-wired elevator to make the police think he's stopping on the third floor. But as the bomber backs up towards the underground parking garage, Harry reminds Jack of the pop quiz, and so he shoots Harry in the leg. This gets him out of the way, but apparently the bomber wired the doorframe with explosives and blows it to cover his escape. Still, Harry and Jack manage to save the passengers, and the police think the bomber is dead, even though they wouldn't have found a body. So the two of them get medals as the bomber watches from his home laboratory. The bomber strikes again the next day by blowing up a bus that a friend of Jack's was driving, and he calls a nearby public phone to give Jack a message. The target wasn't a coincidence. The bomber is getting revenge, but more importantly, he's getting his money. He wants $3.7 million now, and he's rigged a bus with a bomb that will arm when it goes above 50 miles an hour and blow up when it drops below 50. If any passengers leave the bus, the bomb will blow it. And if he doesn't get his money in the next 3 hours, he'll blow it. Jack is allowed to know which bus has the bomb on it, but the bomber has jammed his police radio. Jack pursues the bus onto the freeway, first in his Ford Bronco, and then in a commandeered Jaguar XJS convertible. Fun fact, that convertible was a mod, created by a specialty manufacturer called Hessen Eisenhart. Jack doesn't get to the bus before it hits 50 miles an hour, but he does manage to warn the driver before he drops below it. He then jumps out of the Jag into the bus at speed, and Keanu Reeves scared the crap out of the director by performing the stunt himself. At first, Jack tries to avoid telling the passengers about the bomb, but then some guy who presumably has a record pulls a gun on him and demands that he stop the bus. Jack tries to defuse the situation, but then a well-meaning passenger tackles the gunman, and a wild shot shoots the driver Sam in the shoulder. A passenger, Annie Porter, takes over for him, and Jack explains that they can't bring the poor guy to a hospital because there's a bomb on the bus. Jack uses an early cell phone to get in touch with Harry, who happens to be an expert with bombs. He opens an access panel in the floor to find and describe the bomb. And in particular, he notes that the timer is a cheap gold watch. Between that and the bomber's encyclopedic knowledge of bombs, Harry realizes that he must be a retired member of a police bomb squad. Mac follows the bus in a helicopter and gives Jack directions to an empty freeway. They then hit a baby carriage full of empty cans, and apparently that stunt was harder to pull off than it looks. They then take a turn so hard that the bus goes up on two wheels for a second. Things calm down after they reach the freeway, so Mac brings in a flatbed truck to get the passengers. Jack says they can't do that, especially since the bomber can watch the news footage, and sure enough, the bomber gets back in touch with Jack to warn him. Jack talks him into letting the bus driver off, since he's bleeding to death anyway, but when he does, a passenger panics and tries to follow him. So the bomber blows out the bus steps as a warning, and the passenger dies in the process. The next stunt is a jump over a gap in the freeway that no car in the world could have made. But of course the bus pulls it off because this is an action movie, and physics are optional. After that, Jack directs Annie to the runways of a Los Angeles International Airport. This gives them plenty of open pavement to drive on, plus the bomber can't watch the news choppers anymore since the airport has restricted airspace. Jack convinces the bomber to let him leave to negotiate on his behalf, but he tells Mac to keep the passengers on since the bomber still might have eyes on them. Jack then goes under the bus to try and disarm the bomb, but he fails and then ends up puncturing the gas tank when the police lose control of the towed sledge he's on. The passengers do manage to get him back on board though. Meanwhile, the police discover that the bomber's identity is Howard Payne, formerly of the Atlanta, Georgia Police Department. Unfortunately, Howard was expecting that and rigged his house to explode. Harry is on the team that goes in and dies in the explosion. Howard gives Jack the bad news, and he doesn't take it well. Afterwards, though, Jack notices that Annie has a University of Arizona sweatshirt, and Howard has been calling her a Wildcat, the university's team name. Sure enough, there's a camera behind the center mirror, but there's no microphone. So Mac has a news van locate the camera's signal, tape a loop of it, and then play it back into the feed. With that done, the police can finally get the passengers off the bus, but one of the wheels goes flat, and the bus loses control before Annie and Jack can get off. So they use the center access panel to make a safe-ish escape before the bus hits an empty airplane and blows up. Now, Howard doesn't know the bus blew up thanks to the feed loop, so the police use the dead drop location he provided to lure him out, with a paint bomb and a tracker in the bag, and snipers on the rooftops, naturally. But before he goes to pick up his money, Howard figures out the ruse, And when he spots Annie near the dead drop location, he puts on his old uniform and kidnaps her by pretending to be a cop. Oh, and he gets the money because the dead drop trash can is over an open hole leading to the subway. Jack jumps in the hole and sees someone moving, but it turns out Howard has strapped Annie with dynamite and has a new dead man switch in his hand. Jack is thus helpless as Howard hijacks a subway train and handcuffs Annie to a pole, but he's able to climb on board before the train leaves the station. He then climbs onto the roof of the train, but Howard hears him and starts shooting at random. He then climbs up for a fist fight when he runs out of bullets, and Jack eventually wins by taking Howard's head off with a low-hanging light. There's one last stunt as the subway goes off the rails, and the movie ends with Jack and Annie kissing because at this point action movies had to have a love interest, even when they added nothing to the story or the characters. The Cars. Today's video went flying through the air, so I figure today's car segment should be all about aerodynamics. Now I know it sounds a little strange for ground vehicles to worry about aerodynamics, but consider this. Most of a car moves through the air. Only a few little strips ever touch the ground. As such, the car engine has to do more than just push the car forward. It also has to push all of the air out of the way so that the car can move forward. Now that's not much when you're moving at 10, 20 miles an hour, but once you get up to highway speeds, good aerodynamics can make a big difference. For an airplane, good aerodynamics means having good lift. Plane wings have a very particular shape, designed to create low pressure zones above the wing and high pressure zones below it. The high pressure zone will want to equalize with a low pressure zone, and so it pushes the wing up. The fact that high speed movement creates low pressure zones is called Bernoulli's principle. Another principle used for lift is Newton's laws. If a wing pushes enough air downward, then that downward force will push the wing, and the aircraft attached to it, up. That's why an aircraft can still fly when it's upside down, although you need to be moving pretty fast to be pushing enough air downward. Bernoulli's principle makes it easier for an aircraft to fly at lower speeds. Newton's laws are also why fast cars need downforce. Cars need ground clearance. And because they need ground clearance, some of the air they push through will go under the vehicle. If enough air goes underneath, it'll push the chassis up, and the car will lose grip. And we all know how important grip is. This is especially relevant during high-speed turns, since the lateral G-forces the sideways movement produces tends to push cars off their wheels, like what happened to the bus in the movie. However, if more air goes over the car and pushes it down, then the wheels will stay glued to the pavement, even during a fast turn, and give you excellent grip. That's why a fast car needs downforce. So how do you get downforce? The same way you get lift. With a wing. Of course, car wings don't need to get too fancy with the Bernoulli principle, since they don't also have to control the car's movement. Instead, they could just be a wedge, a narrow triangle pointed forwards and downwards. Now that is a massive oversimplification, and there is a lot of research that goes into every square inch of a racing car wing, but it's at least easier to get downforce with a homemade car wing than it is to get lift with a homemade airplane. Aside from wings, cars can also have spoilers. Wings add downforce, but they also slow a car down because it's catching a lot of air that otherwise would have passed right on by. Spoilers can make your car move faster by blocking air from moving into certain areas. A spoiler can create a sort of pocket of low-pressure air that the high-speed air you're moving through will avoid entering. Effectively, you're changing the shape of your car, as far as air can tell. This lets air move more smoothly around your vehicle, and so the engine doesn't have to push as much air out of the way. To put it simply, a spoiler can improve your highway fuel efficiency, and a wing will help you turn tighter corners. Then there's the diffuser, a relatively new addition to automotive aerodynamics. The air underneath a moving car is going fast, faster than the ambient air around it. And while the low-pressure zone this creates is good for downforce, it also creates drag, where air has to slow back down to match the ambient pressure. The solution is a rear diffuser, a set of fins along the back rear of the car. And these fins provide a transition zone, where air can slow down and contract. You also have splitters at the front of cars, a flat plane that adds downforce and gets air speeding up before it reaches the undercarriage. Of course, cars also have other uses for air. Internal combustion engines need air to work, and I'll be getting more into that later. But if too much air goes into the engine compartment, it'll create drag. That's why some cars come with grille shutters that limit how much air can get into the front grille depending on how fast you're moving, so that only a necessary amount of air gets through. Air is also useful for cooling tires and brakes, so you'll see holes punched into the front corners and the doors of a sports car, holes that direct air exactly where it's needed. For once, I think I've covered all the important stuff, so I guess that's it for today. Thanks for joining me again for today's movie and car review, and I hope I'll see you next time for a TV show about a talking car and some putts in the driver's seat.